like old times. Only better, right?
Better.
Hollywood has come a-calling. They want to make unfinished business into a movie.
Our carefree college days on full display. I love it.
That book caused a lot of drama.
Get your popcorn ready.
Ooh. You need a change of scenery.
So come with us to Quinn's wedding.
It's guaranteed to put a smile on your face.
Think about it. You need to find something you're passionate about. Redefine your purpose.
I thought you found your purpose with that perfume commercial.
Always in my playbook. Always in my playbook.
Oh, wait, I'm sorry.
We all make mistakes.
And you gotta live with the consequences.
I know what it's like to be a tired, overworked, exhausted mom.
Wait, don't you have, like, three nannies?
It takes a village.
Life doesn't always go the way we expect. But if we're lucky, we end up where we're supposed to.
We're actually really looking forward to some husband and wife time.
Yes, we are.
Are you two gonna have sex?
What's sex?
A really yummy dessert. Ooh,
then can I have sex?
Okay.
Do you know who I want to play me?
Who?
Beyonce. Get your coins together, brother.
There was a time jump in there, but after that time jump, that's when things really start to hit the fan. So some strong point premises. You got, what's the football player's name? He's now going to come out of retirement, try to come back at 48 years old. Yeah, Morris Chestnut.
It's a character. How can I think about his name?
But it's cool. But he wanted to come back and play football. His son, which actually the character who plays his son is actually from Dayton.
Really?
Which is pretty cool. So we're hoping to get him on the podcast. Somebody reached out today who has that connection. So hope we can get him on the podcast and continue to expand upon this conversation. But he's going through some life transformational changes as well, which was an impactful thing on how those conversations work amongst their fathers. You had one that was dealing with herbal medicine, which was a big one. Mm-hmm. You know, predatorial, you know, it was a lot of things that movie dealt with. But from a Black love perspective, we want to kind of get up on the love triangle between Jordan, Harper, and Sanaa Lathan's character. What's her name? What's her name in the show? And that's why she felt upset because she was not seen. And nobody knew who she was. But that's kind of your thoughts on that whole premise of it. Because as I look back and seen it, we had this whole conversation. I thought that, you know, Jordan and Harper never really, some folks said that they didn't have their moment. I was telling my sister, you know, prior to this, I don't think that she really wanted to be with him for real. I think that she wanted to follow her path, but if Harper was there, then it worked itself out. Like,
so what do you think she wanted? Because she made it pretty clear. She kissed him. She, you know, expressed to him what she wanted to happen while his lady at the time was not, you know, there.
See, that was the point of the conversation.
She just wanted a one night.
You talking about it now after I have a woman. So I'm at a wedding that we're all supposed to be here celebrating my man's, and now this is your point that you're going to approach me? We went to college together. That's what I'm saying. Like, there was plenty of choice and tension.
Harper had moved to a different city, I think, right? Him and Sanaa Lathan's character was somewhere else. I don't know if it was Chicago or somewhere else. They weren't in New York with everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're in a different city from this person that you had some sort of connection with back in college, and you have an opportunity to reconnect with this person, then, because who likes a long-distance relationship?
I think I agree with Durant on this one.
This is a
I feel like just off of the premise, and a premise of the show, and mixing just some things I just see in life, is I think that the idea was always going to be more appealing than the actual, like, relationship. Because it's like, if you look at both of their life paths, they wouldn't have been able to... I don't think that relationship would have actually worked for her. I think it was just like, yo, I want this in this moment because it's something I've always thought about, maybe even fantasized about or whatever else, but in real life, I actually don't want this.
Why don't you think they would have worked together?
I don't. So the thing is, per like just his character development, Harper is just, he's selfish. You know what I mean? I think that that is something, yeah, that man is selfish, but I don't think it's a bad, I don't think it's like that toxic selfishness. I think it's like, yo, I have a passion, I have something I want to do, I'm really driven.
So how would you describe Jordan?
Yeah.
Okay.
But the thing is that I believe that they would have needed someone to acquiesce to the other one, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
I think that he needed to be that guy, and his ego was a big thing in all of these movies. And if you were with a woman that is now that guy, then it's just like, now you're in this kind of war competition with your partner. And also, I think he was able to be as successful because of the support he was given from Robin. So I think a lot of people don't put emphasis on the intangibles. But the intangibles are things that get you across the finish line. And that could just be, you know, the emotional support, the knowing somebody's there, somebody's whatever. When you were working, like she was working, she ain't had time to do that.
Right.
So
that was her name, Robin. We did not want to forget about Robin.
Robin. Yeah.
But no, so to that point though, you said that, you know, Avi Hopper was selfish because he wanted to pursue his goals. But even when he had a family, he was still trying to do it for his family. Now you can say that was selfish to build his own ego up. You can call it whatever you want to call it. That kind of, it almost tells into our last Black love conversation, you know, the whole, if you can, as a Black man, can you empower your woman and empower your, you know, and without, you know, feeling, you know, not just emasculated, but can both be empowered at the same time? Like,
I think that's mostly based on character, like, you know, you in growth. It takes, you know, just like in a relationship, I mean, it takes you years to, you know, learn how to argue. It takes you years to learn how to disagree. Mm-hmm. You know, that's, it's a constant elevation with that. Once you stop wanting to elevate, then I think there goes certain things that really start really to play more hard. And then your selfish, your selfish things come out a lot more when you stop being willing to elevate, I think. Because then it's directly about me. I'm going to make sure I'm good. I'm going to make sure I'm straight. So
let's get into...
Harper had a lot of growth throughout the trilogy,
And that's where it gets to kind of what the question is, right? Who was the real antagonist of this series?
Of the final chapter?
Of the final...
Or the whole...
Let's do final chapter first. Who was the antagonist of the final chapter? Kind of when you literally look at it, who was like the bad guy? And then let's look over the whole piece. Because you always have a protagonist, you have an antagonist. So who was kind of that person that really just was driving the drama?
I think Robin always had an insecurity about Harper and Jordan.
Yeah.
She always, deep down, felt like there was something there.
So is Jordan the antagonist then? Did Jordan create that tension? Because once again, Harper didn't go to that wedding with any intention in the first movie of really trying to get with Nia Long. He went there like, "This is my girl." And then, as you said before, they said they were both selfish, right? You said they were both selfish, and they're in that prime of their lives where it's like, "I want what I want. I want what I want now." And we all kind of are. I don't know when that their age was supposed to be when they got married, but I feel like we're still kind of there, that 25, 35, that kind of range where you feel like you want things now, but it's still, you have some perspective of, I may not get this chance again, right? So was it her that really is at the end of the day? I guess we're answering both questions now. Is she really the antagonist of the whole thing? Is it Nia Long's character?
Is it Jordan? No. Mm-mm. I don't think so.
Perhaps. I hadn't thought too much about that, but she could be, you know.
I don't think so.
I mean, Jordan took Harper on the walk. Jordan was the one that said,
"Yeah,
Jordan's
aggressive."
So
she knew what she was doing.
But, but even when she knew what she was doing, it seemed like she never really. That was why I really, how we started it.
from a woman's perspective, when everybody knows, when you're leaving college, you're not really thinking about marriage like that for real. I know, at least as a man, I wasn't thinking about I'm trying to just get married. But, right. You know, when things happen. But, heck, I didn't get married until I was 31, I think. I know. I am married. I know that part. But no, in all seriousness, though, when you're at that prime of your life and then when somebody actually finds somebody they rock with, yeah, we got maybe some tension or some energy that never really dealt with. But whose responsibility is it to respect that? But then once those boundaries have been crossed now, how do you now move about it? Because you said before, if that's on her onus to respect the relationship, and then once they all become cool again, it's like they're not in the circle. It's
that's
like,
what I was going to say. I just think that if I'm really... So the way they set up their Harper and Jordan's friendship was like they're supposed to be locked in, like really good friends. Mm-hmm. If I know me and my friend had this weird back and forth, but I see that they're clearly moving on and that they're with somebody, then I'm also a part of that. I believe that moral responsibility to see my friend happy and not mess up his stuff. You know what I mean? At the very least, it's to really take in him and his wife as family. You know, if we're really rocking, like we just gonna be friends, then I do have a certain level of responsibility, I would think, to his wife as well as to him.
Acting like you and the wife are friends.
Exactly. Like, it's one thing if you just distance yourself from the situation and say, I'm not dealing with
y'all. I want to hear from Sam on this one.
Do you know, I think the breakdown of everybody missing is why Harper and Jordan never be a couple? It's because they're the exact same person. It's just the female and the male. They have the exact same characteristics. They're both going to choose their self every time.
All right.
So in that's why they could never be, and that's why it's always. You notice they both do the same thing when they're around each other. It's the thought of each other, but when they're not around each other, it's the thought of their job, their career. They play the same game over and over again. Honestly.
So, argument for Jordan on the table, which is a new verdict. You know, new evidence to put Jordan on there. So let's talk about Robin. You said Robin has some insecurities from the jump. So this is now what, 20 years you're now pushing into this saga, this universe. You get now where you not necessarily experience some insecurities about where you stand in this relationship, but it seems like that, right? She's talking about she doesn't feel like she's being seen, or she's not being heard. Which is important. Like you definitely as a man want to make sure that your woman is no matter how big your light is, not feeling like she's a shadow in any situation. So, empowerment or not, I just feel like that's just, you know, but where I feel like it got a little twisted is that she had her own restaurant, right? She had her cooking piece. She, even when she went down to, the first wedding, she's doing her own thing. Like, man, let me talk to the cook to kind of build that relationship up. So she seemed like she always had something that she wanted to go towards. But even to Harper's point, he was like, look, I funded this, I funded that. Like, you moving money around in charities I really don't know about. You out here, I get it. Black Lives Matter. Like, but you protesting with the kid, you getting arrested with my daughter right there. Like, these are some responsibilities that you really have to think about when you're now talking about a family. So, not necessarily push back on Harper being selfish at all times, but maybe he is because he's selfish as a man. You think about your family, but selfishly, I want what's best for my family and for what was best for us. So I only know how to grind. I already know how to push us forward. Just kind of Jordan's, Robin's kind of perspective on it, if anybody kind of has that.
Yeah. I just think that it's like a thing of, you know, sometimes you just want your partner to rock with you. And, like, you know, I'm not saying that's always the most responsible thing, and I can totally get it. When you're in a marriage and you start making decisions, that's going to affect all of us. We all need to really have input. But I can maybe understand her from, like, I just been rocking with you, and I've been rolling with you, and we've been doing this. I just need this time to be about me. So, and I don't know if that was necessarily him having to say yes to everything. Or, like, if he would have said, oh, he would have got this restaurant, if he would have did this or that. I think she just wanted him. You know, and I think she wanted his full support, and I think she wanted him to be as excited. I think the money thing for him was like, yo, I'm funding this stuff. I'm giving money to this stuff. And for her, it's like, yeah, that's cool, and she should appreciate that. And She's just like, yo, but I want you here with me while I'm doing this.
But as a man, you can't do both. Like, I can't, yeah. Like, it's tough. Well, I can't say both. I can't say can't.
But you my time, can give you my money, can give you my money, can give you my time. Not all of it. It's not, you know,
That's not necessarily true either. I think it's not even, it's a fact of compromise, and it's also a fact of communication, right? Mm-hmm. If I don't know what you feel, then I can't really fulfill that need. And of course, if I'm away, I'm not having a conversation about buying a building that me and you about to buy that only you are there to see because we got different eyes. Mm-hmm. Certain things, I'm going in there looking at, you know, yeah. Okay, is this work? Is that work? And yeah. You know what I mean? You might just be looking at the spot itself. Like, we're together because we're a team.
Right.
And that's where we work best, you know? So it's like, if we're doing things solo and we're not communicating that, that just builds up, and once it comes out how it comes out, and I think that's just how it played.
I think when it came to Robin's support of Harper and his writing and all of that, she didn't necessarily have to fund his career, but she was his cheerleader, she was his, mm-hmm. like, his backbone in the sense, and I think that's what, you know, to yeah. agree what you were saying, that's kind of what she was looking for. But,
go ahead.
I understand, you know, financially, that plays a huge part in it.
Yeah.
You know.
And I'm funding your dreams, too. Like, you had a couple different projects that, once again, go ahead.
I'm sorry. So, the point I was going to make is that he wanted to be alone. So, she wanted him to come to Africa with her. So, it wasn't like, I got to chase my dreams, and I just need you to be at home holding it down until I get back. She's like, I want to have this experience together. When he's chasing his shit and doing his stuff, he don't, it's not no invite. Like, it's not like, yo, come with me as I write this stuff. And I get it because that might not be his process or his this or his that. But when she's like, her dreams are all encompassed of the group. His dreams are like, oh, boo, let me go get this money. I'm going to bring that money back home. Let me go get the money, bring it back home.
And inviting him on that pathway. I haven't heard that perspective yet. So one minute, we'll wrap this up. One more minute, because, man, this is dope. I want to make sure we keep us on this time frame. So it sounds like, and let's just kind of, you know, on Harper. I'm sure we're going to put 1 minute and put Harper on the table. Then we'll just kind of let everybody hear their verdict on who was the bad guy in this love triangle. But so we talk about Harper. Harper, obviously, when you start the first book, wrote the book, put his homeboy in there, slept with his homeboy girl, like, just kind of crazy. Second one, like, I don't remember the second one too much.
Did a biography on his homeboy.
Lance.
Did Lance know about it?
No.
Okay, all right. I knew it was something crazy he did in the second one. And then obviously in the third one, it kind of gets bad. Once again, we're going to make a movie. But as you said before, you wanted to ask everybody, you saw growth within that character. You guess what I'm saying? So, yeah, let's kind of get his biggest.
He acted like he didn't want to do those things, but he wanted to do those things.
So, but that gets back to, you know, growth. I may want to do, there's a lot of stuff I want to do, but just because I might internally want to do it doesn't mean I can just act upon it. Like, as a married man, there's a lot of things I want to do, but I don't get to just do them. Like,
the difference is that is it.
I think that's just kind of the premise. Yeah, the premise of the whole situation is that each time he had this, like, I'm not saying we didn't see sacrifice, but he's going to make his movie, he's going to write his book, he's going to spy on his best friend and try to get a biography or whatever else. He's going to move them into a house you don't want to be in. He is going to do these things. Yeah. He's going to kiss his best friend when they be in awkward moments or whatever else. We saw her flirting, but we ain't see her get no physical interaction with nobody. Yeah, and it's just one of the things.
She
like,
ate his mushrooms, man.
He's the bad guy.
Harper's
yeah.
friend is going to talk behind your back and smile on your face.
Harper does what's in the best interest of Harper.
Yeah, at the end, what you said.
So you got a Harper. So Harper?
Yeah, I'm going to go.
Harper.
Yeah, us is definitely.
I'm going with Jordan, damn it. Jordan, the bad guy. that's dope. That's dope. Now, leave your comments. Say, who do you really think was kind of responsible of just kind of as this whole thing ended, kind of the downfall, especially their marriage? Because, man, the dopest, the, saddest scenes, especially as a father, when she drove off with that little girl in the car. That was so tough. But then the kind of have a storytelling piece of it when his homeboys was kind of there. Like, just as a black man, you felt those pieces.
Yeah.
My whole thing about the whole best man side, I thought that from black storytelling, I love that we can now tell stories that are about us, that people that really look like us from a lot of different antics, right?
Yeah.
Last time we were talking about from a Black Panther's perspective. These weren't always things that we could do. Like, whether or not you agree with the movie, whether or not you agree with what the characters are doing, we're really allowed to have these conversations now. And I really think that's just a testament of a lot of people that paved the way to where we are. So, speaking of it,